我哋。
Members, it's the appointed time. We have a quorum. I call the meeting to order. First of all, I welcome members to this meeting. Since the last meeting, we have received no information papers. Item for discussion at the next meeting, there are two papers. First is CB(1217/16-17)(01). The other one is (02). Please refer to these two papers. But in the regular meeting in January 2017, we will discuss two items, that is, the long-term housing strategy annual report 2016 and also priorities of demand for public rental housing. Well, since there are a lot of common grounds in the above two items, and in order to allow more time for members to have discussions, we will adopt a previous approach, that is, papers will be submitted separately, but we will have a joint discussion session to allow more time. So, any other views? And also, list of outstanding items, 16 to 19 of the list of follow-up actions, 16 to 19, that is in relation to income and net asset declarations, well-off tenants policies, housing schemes. We will be able to address the issues that are close to the hearts of members in the next regular meeting when we talk about demand for public housing in the next meeting. So in relation to the priorities, does it include well-off tenant policies? Yes. Well, without further ado, we move on to item 3. Let's invite the administration to join us. It's Head 711, project number B778CL1, site formation and infrastructure works for public housing developments at Tsung Kwan O Road and Area 9, Tai Po, Phase 1, and number B781CL, infrastructure works for public housing development at Area 54, Tung Chung, and number B186GK, ancillary facilities block at Tseung Kwan O Area 65C2. There are a number of officials here with us. I'm going to dispense with the introduction. You'll find the attendance list in front of you. I will ask the official to give us a PowerPoint presentation. Well, because of time constraint, please be concise. Chairman and members, the purpose of this paper is to ask for members' support to upgrade certain projects to Cat A. They are site formation and infrastructure work at Tsung Kwan O Road and infrastructure work for Tung Chung Area 54 and ancillary facilities block at Tung Chung at Tsung Kwan O Area 65C2. The first item is in Tai Po. This is for site formation and to build a new road and infrastructure for public housing development at Tsung Kwan O Road East and West. In order to tie in with the public housing development, the project will commence in two parts. First is B778CL1, which is the first part. It will be upgraded to Cat A. This involves the forming of land, construction of new roads, and to provide infrastructure, ancillary works to tie in with the population intake of Tsung Kwan O Road and Area 9 Tai Po Phase 1. The proposed infrastructure work has to be completed on time to tie in with the population intake of Tsung Kwan O Road and Area 9 Tai Po. the developments will be completed in 2021, 22, and 2022, 23. It will accommodate about 7,000 flats, housing about 15,000 people. And in relation to consultation, on the 9th of March 2016, we have consulted the Environmental Housing and Works Committee of the Tai Po District Council. Members expressed support. And on the 8th of May 2015, under the Roads Ordinance, we have already gazetted the relevant work. We have received no objections. And on the 28th of May, we have gazetted the proposal. The estimated capital cost will stand at 1.1468 billion dollars. Work will commence in mid 2017. It will be completed in mid 2020 and late 2022. The second project is the infrastructure works for public housing development at Area 54 Tung Chung. This is to provide facilities to tie in with the public housing development at Area 54 Tung Chung. There will be a new carriageway infrastructure and other ancillary works completed. A pavement cycling track, amenity areas, and also a bus depot near Ying Hei Road. There will also be a pumping station constructed. We need to construct new roads and ancillary works to tie in with the development. If these items are completed, it will be able to tie in with the population intake of the site. The project will be completed in 2021-22, providing 3,300 flats housing 10,000 people. On the 1st of February 2016, we've consulted the Islands District Council. Members expressed support. On the 15th of September 2016, under the Roads Ordinance and also the Water Pollution Regulation, we have gazetted the proposed work. We have not received any objections, and that will be proper gazetto later. The estimated capital cost at money of the day price, it will stand at $284.8 million. Work will commence in mid 2017 to be completed in mid 2020. The third project is the ancillary facilities block at Tseung Kwan O Area 65C2. In order to tie in with the public housing development at this area, we propose to construct an ancillary facilities block to accommodate an activity, a center, and five social welfare facilities, elderly center, family services center, and early education center, youth outreach center, and related facilities. This is the time with the public housing development at Area 65C at Tseung Kwan O Area. It will provide 1,400 flats housing 4,300 people. Venues will be provided under this development for community and social welfare facilities. On the 4th of November 2014 and the 7th of July 2015, we have consulted the Sai Kung District Council. We have already addressed the various issues raised by members. We will provide these facilities to tie with the housing development. In relation to this project, the estimated capital cost at money of the day price is $235.2 million. Work will commence in late 2017. And in order to tie with the population intake at this site, this project will start at the same time. We estimate that the project will be completed in early 2020. There are six members who have raised their hands. Well, for items 2 and 3, I believe there will be more hands. So I would like to finish this item as soon as possible. Who else would like to ask questions? Wu Qiwei, Ray Chan? I'll draw a line here. Eight members. Pun Xiuping, Yu Chung Yim, KK Kwok, and a few other members. First, Pun Xiuping. In principle, sorry. Each member will have 4 minutes, and I have to say something. Well, if there are direct and indirect peculiar interests under discussion, members, please disclose the nature of the interest before you speak under ROP 83A. And also, pay attention to Rule 84 of the ROP in relation to voting on the items with direct pecuniary interest. Pun Xiuping, I would like to know more about Tai Po Area 9, Chung Ngah Road. Just now, the administration said that there will be 7,000 flats housing about 17,000 people. I would like to ask something about the road from Tseung Kwan O Court to Tai Po Center. The roads are quite busy. So, does the administration have any statistics about the road capacity? With these housing developments, do you have any information about the future traffic volume and pedestrian volume? Who is to take this question? Mr. Low or Mr. Tang? The consultant has done a traffic impact assessment. For these roads, especially Tseung Kwan O Road, the vehicle and pedestrian volume are quite low before the development and after the development as well. The capacity is 0.58, that is already the highest. It shows that the surrounding roads of Tseung Kwan O Road still have a lot of capacity. However, for existing junctions, there may be congestion. So three junctions will be widened. And for some junctions, signaling will be installed to ensure that there is enough capacity at these junctions. And according to the assessment of the consultant, after the development, the surplus capacity or reserve capacity of the junction is about 16%. So after the development, the roads and the junctions will have sufficient capacity. Well, of course, we will believe the information supplied by the government. There will be an additional 17,000 people living there. We hope that there will be enough capacity. But there are some members who have just joined us. We still have two other items, and a lot of members, I believe, will ask questions. Leung Chae Cheong and Mr. Leung Kwok Hong.
If you want to ask a question, please raise your hand and I'll really draw a line there, and I will have to disappoint members who might come in later. Thank you. Mr. Edward Yu and then KK Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. I have discovered that the average pricing for these two projects is quite different. I'd like to ask the administration whether they have detailed information to explain the difference in pricing. Tai Po, 1.168 billion for 7,700 units, or $162,000 per flat. That is to provide the infrastructure. And the other one, it only costs $284.8 million. but there will be 3,300 units, and the average price will be $86,000 per flat. I understand the environment in the vicinity and the ground conditions may be different, but we need more information to decide whether we would support the funding request for the relevant infrastructure. Didi, thank you, Mr. Yu, for the question. As Mr. Yu said, the infrastructural complement will be different, and therefore the pricing is different. As to the detailed information, perhaps I can ask my colleague in the team to let you know the answer. Is it Mr. Chan? I can talk about Tung Chung first. The Tung Chung project is relatively simpler. We have already completed the main road, which is Yinghe Road. We now have to provide an approach road going into the public housing site. We also have to build some sewage infrastructure so we can connect with the sewage pumping station. Therefore, we can't mention this in one breath with the Tai Po situation, and may I defer to Mr. Tang to speak on Tai Po. Mr. Tang, yes, Tai Po is a little different. There are two parts. One is Area 9. We need to do site formation there. We need to excavate 3 to 7 meters. We also have to build a road. And there will be many utilities underground, including stormwater drains and other pipes. And this will link up Chung Ah Road with Area 9 of Tai Po. As for Chung Ah Road, there will be potable water pipes and also sewage pipes. These pipes will serve Area 9 of Tai Po, but it will also serve the Chung Ah Road West site. As the DD said, we have divided this project into two parts. One is Area 9 and the other one is Chung Ah Road East site. And we have not really submitted site formation for Chung Ah Road West site. However, the sewage pipes and also the stormwater drains are also serving Chung Ah Road West site. Can you provide a breakdown of the cost and more detailed cost analysis? Yes, we have the information. If you need it, we can supplement it after the meeting. Okay, do so after the meeting. And also, may I add, you don't have time. You can give a written reply to Mr. Yu, Mr. K.K. Kwok, and then Mr. Cheng Chong Tai. I like to ask about the Tai Po project, which is going to cost 1146.8 million. Today, we know from news reports that the provision in new PRH is done not in a satisfactory manner, and people are dismantling the sinks and other provisions in new PRH, and that's a huge waste of money. So I like to ask about the new PRH and the design, so people will not throw away the kitchen sinks once they move in. How can you make sure that this will not happen in Tai Po? Number two, the community building complex in Tseung Kwan O, it is of a rather low height. Have you maximized the use of the site? Because in Tseung Kwan O, we do not have FEHD, co-food stores and markets. We only have Link and small developers. Can you make that building taller so we can have a market and also a co-food store? And there are no facilities for the elderly either. There is no institutional care for the elderly. Why don't you maximize the use of that site, Didi? Thank you for the questions and proposal. First, These are infrastructural projects.
Oh, and of course, another one is a facilities block. We are not building any PRH yet.
The so-called news report today, says that some kitchen sinks have been thrown away by residents of new PRH, but that has nothing to do with quality. We have monitored our projects very closely. We believe the reports do not reflect fully the reality.
Coming back to these projects and Tseung Kwan O, whether there will be markets in the facilities block, can I defer to my colleague, Ms. Tam, and also from SWD, Mr. Kwok, who can answer the question. Ms. Anne-Marie Tam.
With regard to the ancillary facilities block in Tseung Kwan O Area 65C2, in the entire area there, we have maximized the use of the site. The plot ratio is 3.3 for residential areas and non-residential only 0.5. We have already made use of the maximum plot ratio allowed. We have applied that principle when we did the design. As for the welfare facilities, we have discussed with district councils and we have done our own consultation, and we have also discussed with the SWD. So we have decided on such welfare facilities and community facilities.
You mean you don't need any institutional care facilities?
Mr. Kwok, let me answer the question. When we considered the use of this site, we have consulted the district council. We know that there will be an elderly neighborhood center and also facilities for children and young people. As for institutional care, that is being designed in other areas in Tseung Kwan O.
And also through the special scheme to use private land for welfare services.
Well, sorry, your time is up, Mr. Kwok and the Housing Department. When the paper goes to PWSC, please let us know the facilities in that block. I would like to single this out for voting. Mr. Cheng Chung Tai and then Fernando Zheng. I'd like to have asked a few questions about Area 9 Tai Po. Residents there are worried that their traffic will be impacted by Area 9 and Chong Ah Road developments. I'd like to know whether there will be a redirection of certain bus routes, because these areas are very far away from the MTR station and you really have to think about traffic. Number two, there are two hospitals nearby. I'd like to know, you have considered whether there will be impact on emergency services of the hospitals when you undertake these infrastructural projects, because those hospitals are quite busy. DD, about traffic, can I defer to the CEDD, please? And as for the various assessments, we have done very detailed analysis. Mr. Tang, usually after occupation intake, or actually before that, the TD will look at the situation, and also after population intake, the TD may redirect certain bus routes. Right now, we don't have the information. As to possible impact on the hospitals from the project, we will state in the contract to require the contractor to provide temporary traffic measures and also environment measures. We need to have such plans from them before they will be allowed to start work. There will be more cars, but in the roads near the hospitals, we will pave noise reduction material, so hospital operation will not be affected. Sorry, do I have 4 minutes?
Yes.
The residents in Fuhang in particular have spoken out about
traffic. As you know, 74X, 75X, these buses are quite old type buses, and later on you would be moving in over 7,000 flats of people, and you must think about traffic burden. Any supplement from the administration about traffic planning? DD, just a small point. Area 9 in Tai Po will have a public transport interchange, and bus services will be provided. But this project does not include that PTI. I understand. Another point, since I still have time, this is about the ancillary facilities block in Tseung Kwan O. You are going to build a three-story building, and it was decided 2-3 years ago. And at that time, this was to serve some public housing. And that is why you have this design. But I'd like to know whether you are adjusting the design. Will there be swimming pool and a sports complex? Because 2-3 years have lapsed and different types of housing have been built in Tseung Kwan O. DD? In area 65C2, in another lot, there will be facilities including a swimming pool, but it is not in 65C2. It is included in another project. Thank you. I don't have other questions. Fernando Zheng and then Eddie Chu. Thank you, Chairman. About the Tai Po project, we have some reservations because it's a green belt. The administration is going to rezone a few green belts in Tai Po for housing. If you build public housing, we will support you in principle. But during the consultation period, I think you have done a sloppy job. Residents in the vicinity do not seem to know about it. Well, it is on a high land and it is not easy to access. And as Mr. Chen Chung Tai said, residents are very worried about the future traffic situation because 17,000 people will be moving in. So there will be more burden in Fuhang Estate. I understand in 2009 you already mooted the project with the District Council. At that time, the administration said that in fact you should not build high density and tall residential buildings, but you have made an about turn today, and I think you need to explain your stance. And then the Tseung Kwan O Ancillary Facilities Block, we welcome the Elderly Neighborhood Center and Integrated Family Service Center, and also Special Children Center, and also Early Education Center, and also services for the young. However, in Tseung Kwan O, one of the characteristics is that there are many young parents and there is a gross shortage of nursery or childcare services. There are fewer than 1,000, like 700 places for childcare services for children aged 0 to 2 years old. In Tseung Kwan O, there are only 44 half-day care places. I'd like to ask you whether you have any intention of providing nursery or childcare services in this block or in other facilities. DD? First question. And the consultation, why did we say this site should not be used for public housing, but now it is a suitable site? It is because in 2009, when we looked at the scope of development and also the number of blocks that can be built, we felt that we could only provide 1,000 flats.
Well, along one road, if there are only 1,000 flats, we would not be able to provide much supporting facilities. And now the scale of the site is bigger, and there will be retail facilities, public transport facilities. So it's a small community. It can be developed into a small community, so it's suitable for public housing development. And we have to provide infrastructure, and that will create economies of scale. And when it comes to social welfare facilities, I'll defer to Mr. Kwok. Thank you. For the other areas under planning, say for example Area 67 in Tseung Kwan O, there will be some nurseries. Services mentioned by Mr. Zheng will be provided, not just in this area. And for other areas where there are opportunities, we will increase nursery services and also childcare services. So in the coming 5 years in Tseung Kwan O, how many new additional places for childcare service will you be providing? May I give you the information after the meeting? If you want our support before you go to the Public Works Subcommittee, you need to supply the information to us before that. Mr. Eddie Zhu, then Mr. Wu Chi-wai. For the Tai Po project, I would like to point out that it is a part of the rezoning of the Green Belt in Tai Po. And in the rezoned area of 18 hectares, that is 66%, will be for private development. And for 9 hectares, that is the site behind Fuhang Estate, that will be for public housing. I see that the Hong Kong SARG is blindly grabbing land to develop land. And 66% after the rezoning of a green belt is for private housing. That is completely unacceptable. My first question is, well, for the 18 hectares, some has already been sold. This Shantong Road near Lai Chi Shan has been sold. So I want to ask, will the housing authority increase the amount of public housing in other rezoned green belt? I thank the member for the question. The housing department or the housing authority will take into account the site before working out the amount of public housing to be provided. If there are suitable sites, we will conduct studies. Well, for the sites, my view is that there are some sites that are quite close to Tai Po Market, the train station, say Shantong Road. You sold the piece of land at a very cheap price to a Chinese company. So you want to sell land for profit, or you want to provide housing? Well, I don't think I'm the person to answer your question, but if the site is suitable for public housing development, we will conduct studies and we will develop the site as soon as possible. For Tai Po residents, they see that the 17,000 people will be put behind Fuhang Estate. They will feel that the place will be cramped. That's normal, because most of the bus routes will go via Tai Po Center, Po Heng Bridge to Kwong Fook Road. How come the government department's mentality and the TIA done is so different from the perception of the public? I would like to defer to the CEDD, Mr. Tang, to comment about the traffic impact assessment. Mr. Tang, as I said, the consultant has already conducted a TIA. The capacity before development at Chung Ah Road is 0.3. After development is increased to 0.5. Sorry. You said that the transport will only think about bus routes after population intake. Is that right? I know that there are new bus routes being planned. How many buses will there be? So we can make calculation to see if there's enough, if the vehicular, if the traffic volume increase will be accommodated. As I said, the transport department will, before population intake, rationalize bus routes. We don't have the information yet. And the housing department has already said that in Area 9, there will be a new PTI. Your time is up. Well, before you go to the PWSC, please supply us all traffic information you have. Yes, well, the official talk about TIA, I hope we will be able to see it. Thank you. Next, Mr. Wu Chi Wai. He's just gone out. Mr. Ray Chen to be followed by Mr. Leng Chi Cheng. Thank you. I want to ask about Area 9 of Tai Po. In Annex 1, Paragraph 8, that's what the government said, that on the 9th of March 2016, when they consulted the Tai Po District Council Environmental Housing and Works Committee, members show support, so I dug up the minutes of meeting. It says that 7,070 units will be provided, and 17,500 people will be housed. However, from the District Council paper, it said that 7,800 units will be provided, housing 19,900 people. Well, here we are talking about Chung Au Road East and Area 9, excluding Chung Au Road West. That's why there is a difference. And that's why I said that a part of it will be upgraded to Cat A, the remaining may be upgraded, depending. So the difference will be the units in Chung Au Road West. Yes. So, about the site formation of Tai Po Area 9, has there been any environmental impact assessment done? How many trees will be moved? And if you refer to the Tai Po District Council paper dated the 9th of March, it says that under the project, 1,900 trees will be moved. And in the paper, it talks about a preliminary EIA. What do you mean by preliminary? Does it mean that there is going to be a final or a comprehensive EIA done? We've done some assessments. I will defer to my colleague, Mr. Leung, for more information. Thank you for the question. Well, as members are aware, in the Tai Po 9 and Chung Au Road East, we have to move some trees. For Tai Po 9, about 1,900 trees. And these trees were the result of vegetation in the 1990s when we were dealing with the slope. They were species that are quite intrusive, they are not rare, and they grow very quickly. But if we can avoid falling some trees, we will do so. From the information we have, 10 trees will be replanted. So there are about 1,800 trees that will be felled. Well, the paper says that the Tai Po DC supported it, but I saw that there are two motions. There is one that is voted down by, and there is the other one that is carried, requiring the Chung Au Road West development to be consulted again. So is it going to be done? So that is the Chung Au Road West. Perhaps I will continue with my answer. For Chung Au Road West, there are a lot of issues involved. We have to revise the design, and at the right time, we will consult the DC again before we proceed. Next, Mr. Leung Chi Cheng, to be followed by Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. Well, two sites, Tung Chung and Tai Po. They are for public housing. What do you mean? Home ownership scheme housing or public public residential housing? For Tung Chung, it seems that the ratio is more reasonable. Say, for example, a 3,300 flat housing, about 10,000 people. But for Tai Po, it's different. It's about 6,000 units housing 16,000 people. So the number of people housed in Tai Po is lower. Is it because of the flat sizes? For Tung Chung, it's a subsidized flat for sale. So each unit will house about 3 people. For Tai Po, there is a combination. Some are PRH units. And we've worked out that it will house about 17,000 people. Some of the units are small. Tai Po is quite remote. It's quite remote. You have to go past a hospital and another public housing estate. And for Tung Chung, it faces the sea, so it's for sale. Of course, you can fetch a higher price, that's for sure. I don't understand why such information is missing. It will help us understand the nature of the housing. They may be public housing, but those for sale and those for rental are different. I hope you will give us more information. I don't need an answer, it's just a comment. I want to know, you have been working on these two sites for over 10 years. For Tai Po, it started in 2009. So could you have compressed the consultation and your works? It's taken 10 years. And if I am right, I don't think anyone's living there. So you don't need to resettle anyone. There are two questions there. First, in relation to consultation, and two, whether there are other considerations. In relation to the nature of housing, we did not deliberately say whether it's for sale or for rental. But when we calculate the number of people to be housed, we work based on an established mechanism. And in 2009, when we first consulted about the site, we thought that this site was not suitable for housing because you had to go via a hospital. It will only provide about 1,000 flats, so it wasn't deemed suitable. However, a number of years passed, the plan has gone through some significant changes. The site has grown, and there will be PTI, there will be a bus interchange, there will be pedestrian walkways walking from Chung-A Road East to Tai Po Area 9. Previously, there was no mention whatsoever about the project at Chung-A Road East. So for Chung-A Road East, West and Area 9, the entire project is more reasonable with the provision of transport supporting facilities. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, to be followed by Mr. Wu Chi Wai. Well, now you seem to welcome the four legislators that are facing disqualification, but it's for you, Anthony Cheung, whether to answer or not. I want to ask about Tai Po. This morning, when I was listening to the radio, it said that the government was the government felt good about itself because the housing supplies will stand at the highest. And when it comes to public housing, it's a record low, and that includes rental and subsidized housing.
But look at Tai Po. You take 27 hectares of land, 9 will be for the building of subsidized or public housing, 18 hectares for private housing. You are using money to form the site and you provide basic facilities and you are going to benefit everybody. It means you form the site and 2/3 of it will be used for the building of private housing, only 1/3 for PRH. the distance is getting wider and wider. Why is that so? Why is it that you are going to sell most of the public housing you will build? This is because you will benefit the bankers because people will have to take out mortgage. First of all, you benefit the developers, you give them the land, and then you sell the subsidized housing, so you benefit the banks. What kind of administration is this? Anthony Zheng may not be able to answer the question. Of course, he will have to ask Paul Chan, who is number one Leung fans. And even Eddie Chu is going to ask you, you can't answer it. That is your land policy. The poor can only have canned sardine fish, but the rich are getting richer. We are building more private housing to start with, and those who can't get PRH don't even have decent housing, and you use 2/3 of the land for private housing and 1/3 for public housing, which is for sale. The infrastructure is going to be provided by government. You are asking us for $200 million for the three projects. What kind of administration are you? If you are poor in Hong Kong, you live in a subdivided unit, and you line up for 5 years, I congratulate you if you are rehoused in public housing. If not, you can live in private housing, but you don't have enough to eat or to buy clothing. You should call yourself lucky if eventually you get PRH. Or you should put away enough money to buy smaller and smaller private flats, which are getting more and more expensive. So the entire policy is gravitated towards developers and bankers. And my question is, later on, Mr. Anthony Zheng will come here. He may not have to answer my question because the government says we are the subject of judicial review cases to be disqualified. This is my remark. I think they have stood original policies on their head. Wu Chi-wai, two questions. I'd like to ask two questions. We know that in your allocation policy, if it is a 4P family, usually they have to wait longer, much longer. I'd like to ask about the flat mix for these projects. Do you follow the demand as reflected by the waiting list to make sure that the housing you provide will really tally with the household mix in the waiting list? Secondly, there are many people who are singletons in the waiting list. And if they are non-elderly, they may have to wait for 30 years because there is the quota and points system. Will the housing department consider the supply of singleton units? I let you to adjust the ratio so that you have a policy to take care of the demand. And lastly, I'd like to ask whether you have maximized the use of land in these three projects vis-a-vis welfare services, including elderly services. Have you maximized the plot ratio for non-residential use in these three sites? And can you let me know what kind of non-residential users are there in these three projects? Didi, thank you, Mr. Wu. I'll answer the last question first. We have maximized all the plot ratios in the three projects. And as for the non-residential use, they would include retail and welfare services. And the calculation is different for the different lots. Can you provide the calculation method and also the details? Didi, can you provide the information? We don't have the information now, because we are only talking about infrastructural building in these three projects. Can you give us the information after the meeting? Well, yes, we can provide the information. And another point has to do with allocation and flat mix. Generally speaking, we would look at the needs of different households and singletons and provide a flat mix. Usually, in order to meet the needs of different household sizes and singletons, we will develop according to the general demand. Well, I understand what you are saying, but I'd like to point out, let us talk about 3P families. Usually, they do not have to wait as long as 4P families. As you know, some 4P households have waited 7-8 years before getting a flat. I'd like to ask you whether you would adjust your flat mix because of the long waiting time for 4P families. And in fact, the 3-year average waiting time is not upheld for some particular types of households. Some have to wait much, much longer. DD, please note this. And also, in the next regular meeting, we are going to talk about supply of public housing. Maybe you can raise the question again. Well, generally speaking, we allocate new flats and also flats surrendered back to the housing department. So by way of allocation, we don't only look at new flats. We understand. But 4P families are waiting extremely long for a flat. I'd like to ask members whether you support submitting the three projects to the PWSC. Those who agree? Just now, Mr. K.K. Kwok has asked to single out the Tseung Kwan O project for voting. Okay, we thank the administration team for coming. Next item on the agenda, further measures to address the overheated residential property market. You should have the speaking note of the Secretary for Transport and Housing tabled for you. Those members who would like to speak, please raise your hands because I need to manage the time. We still have item 3, which is also going to raise a lot of concern. We have the Secretary for Transport and Housing and his team. I won't read out the names. I would give the floor to the Secretary first. Because of time constraint, please be very brief because we already have your speaking note. Madam Chairman, before I speak on the new demand management measures on residential property market announced on the 4th of November, I'd like to reiterate our main policy direction. Housing is an important topic for people's livelihood. Our objective is to maintain a robust and healthy property market, and we have a two-pronged approach. First of all, we have a supply led strategy in order to provide land for more housing in the short, medium, and long terms. And with the continued effort of the administration, we have more and more housing being supplied. Apart from public housing, as at the end of September, there will be 93,000 flats in the first-hand private residential market in the next 3 to 4 years, and it is an all-time high since September 2004 when we started to release quarterly figures. And also, we are going to take, and we actually took demand-led measures in order to cool down the overheated market and the possible negative impact it may cause. And we have already succeeded in stamping speculation. In October, short-term resale only takes up 0.4% of all residential property transactions, which is way below the 20% from January to November 2010, that is before the introduction of SSD. And it's also way below that in December 2010 to October 2012, and that is after introduction of SSD, but not before the enhanced SSD. At that time, the percentage of 14.8%. And in October, the transactions involving non-local individuals and non-local companies, that would take up only 1.8% of all residential property transactions, which is way below the 4.5% in January to October 2012, that is before the introduction of BSD. There was some cooling in the property market at the end of last year, but it started to pick up again in the second quarter, and the property has become exuberant again. And the expectation of prices continually going up has led the sentiments in the market. Between March and October this year, the prices have rebounded by 11.9%, concentrating in small and medium-sized units, and the one-month rise was 3% in September or 2.6% in October. And the overall prices in October was only 0.8% lower than in September. And the mortgage payment to income ratio for the public has again worsened to 59% in the first three quarters. If the interest rate will go up by 3%, that ratio will worsen to 77%. What is causing a concern is that there is again more demand for investment, and the residential property transactions involving DSD has increased by 50% in August and September, and it is a record high of 2,600 cases in September, or 29% of total residential property transactions. In October, it lowered to 2,100 cases, but it still took up 28% of the total transactions. And in these property transactions, Hong Kong PRs who are a beneficial owner of some other residential property in Hong Kong rose from an average of 500 every month in the first quarter to 2,300 in September and 1,700 in October. All these show that the property market have again deviated from our economic fundamentals. If we do not take resolute measures to stabilize the market and allow the bubble risk to continue to worsen, then it will have a negative impact on our macro economy and the stability of our financial system. And that is why we are going to take another round of demand-led measures. And we said that from midnight on the 5th of November, we would again impose a 15% AVD so as to increase the transaction cost in order to cool down the market. However, because we have to take care of the property buying needs of Hong Kong permanent residents, the exceptions will again apply. If a Hong Kong resident who is not a beneficial owner of any other residential property at the time of buying, they can still pay at scale 2 when they pay the AVD. We also propose to reserve the refund mechanism for Hong Kong PRs under DSD so that Hong Kong PRs can buy property first and then sell off their original property. We are now drafting the new bill in order to submit it to LegCo in due course.
The new measures are recognized by the by society. According to a poll, the result of which was released on the 30th of November by the Hong Kong Institute of Asia Pacific Studies of the CUHK, 42% of the respondents expressed support of the new measures, 34% was not sure, and only 18% opposed to the new measures. Of course, there are many factors that are in play that would affect the prices of property, and especially when it comes to external environment and also flow of capital. However, if the government does not take immediate measures to deal with the exuberance of the market, then prices will be pushed up. And since the November, after the new measures have been put in place, there has been the rising up of the of prices have been abated somewhat. And I would like to emphasize again that we respect free market principle and we respect the operation of the market. That hasn't changed. But in order to enable a healthy and stable development of the property market and to reduce the risk of bubbles, in order to serve the best interest of the public, we have to launch demand side management measures, and we will continue to monitor the situation. Well, I know that members would like to ask questions. Each member will be given 3 minutes. I'll read out some names. Kwok Wai Kung, KK Kwok, Lau Siu Lai, Yu Chung Yim, Tam Men, Jeremy Tam, Luk Chung Hong, Eddie Ju, and Andrew Wen, and James Toh. Anyone else who would like to ask questions, please raise your hands. First, Mr. Kwok Wai Kung. In order to curb the exuberance of the property market, once again, the government has resorted to imposing demand-side management measures to deal with the situation. But it only tackles the symptoms without actually addressing the roots of the problem. Under the new AVD, ad valorem duty, you see that for low-price properties, that is, those under $2 million, is an increase of 10 times in the ADV. For those between 4 to 6 million, is about 2 times or so. And those over 20 million, it's an increase of less than 100%. So is it the government's intention to move speculators towards luxurious flats? We all know that the Hong Kong property market is too small. So whether it is a mass market flat or luxurious flat, as soon as there is an increase, all the other types of properties will follow suit. So why does the government deal with it this time? Why don't they increase the AVD for medium to high price properties to about 10 times? Has any assessment been done on the new measures? For those who would like to buy their property, they have fewer choices because sellers are reluctant to put their flats in the market. Secretary, well, for scale 1 AVD, it's about 100% more than the AVD rate at scale 2, but it's progressive. So for cheaper flats, the rates will be lower, the duty will be lower. But we have seen that for mass market flats, the extent of increase is much higher than other types. If we keep it at 15%, and if it's not a flat rate, and if instead we use a progressive rate, the exuberance of mass market flats will not abate. It will even get worse. Under a flat rate for the double stamp duty, DSD, AVD scale at 2, the difference may be smaller. Yes, that's true. Dr. Kokaki, to be followed by Ms. Lau Siu Lai. I think the government is very good at kidding itself. In the medical sector, there is a procedure. They will cut down the size of your stomach so that you will eat less. So I think the secretary has adopted this policy. They just shrink the appetite so that you will feel full. And we've heard that there was a transaction involving 14 luxurious flats in one go. Are you in any way able to deal with the situation when the transaction of many flats is done under one single contract? I think the government aims at increasing flat supply in the primary market, but 40% of the buyers are local buyers. Well, the government are non-local buyers. You said there is only about 2% of them that are non-local buyers. For these non-local buyers, the 15% or even 30% of AVD. Well, how come the government is not hitting where it hurts? Anything to do with people's livelihood, they are subject to speculation. Say, for example, parking spaces. In, say, a normal housing development, the parking spaces are for speculation. Rental, as a result, has been pushed up. When will the government regulate these? Well, we're not talking about speculation of office spaces. We're talking about parking spaces for non-residential property. At the time when we introduced the new flat rate of 15%, we saw that these prices have been stable. And in recent months, there's been a drop. But if there is a hike of property prices for non-residential, if there is overheating in that market, we will take action. What about non-local buyers? For non-local buyers, our record is based on those who have paid the DSD. Well, then where does the data of a centerline come from? Well, we use the data from the IRD. So what about a single transaction involving hundreds of millions of dollars? Ms. Lau Siulai. Well, have you received any instruction from the government that you will not answer questions from the four legislators who are subject of judicial reviews? I know that this afternoon the CS4A will discuss this matter with the chairman of the House Committee. And in this panel, well, without affecting the litigation involving the four legislators, we are willing to answer questions. It's your duty, not whether you wish to or not. And I think in recent years, every time the government launched these demand-side management measures is to tackle the symptom only, because it will only drive down the number of transactions, and property prices will drop for a very short time, only to be picked up very quickly again. So these measures has done nothing to cool down the market. And as some other members have said, it has actually affected genuine buyers. It hasn't deterred speculators at all. So are you sincere in combating rising property prices? Are there any other reasons that cause the increasing property prices? Are there any other solutions, say, for example, increasing the supply of public housing so that ordinary citizens will have a roof over their head, so that property prices will decrease? Secretary, you must be happy because at least she said that you have tackled the symptoms. Of course, we will leave no stone unturned to deal with the situation. We have met a lot of challenges. We'll try to overcome them as far as possible. We know that the most effective way is to address the imbalance. But property prices is not just affected by supply. It's affected by the ultra-low interest rate, capital flow, and also liquidity in the market. Looking back at all the measures, say, in 2013, since the launching of the DSD, we see that there has been a marked increase in investment demand. And that came from local buyers. You are very concerned about first-time buyers who are local citizens. We have balanced all the factors and we've decided to impose a new flat rate of 15% of AVD. Ms. Lau, a question for the chairman. You did not address me as the Honorable Miss Lau Xiaolai, but you have used the word honorable for other members. How come? Well, I want to say that for the chairman's menu, there is no rule about addressing a member. No, I wasn't asking about the rule. I want to ask whether you are insinuating anything. Are you serious? You want to hear the word honourable? I don't want to waste my time. Mr. Yu Si Wing, to be followed by Jeremy Tam. Mr. Yu Chung Yim. Well, one of the reasons put forward by the Secretary is that there has been a marked increase of investment demand. According to the Rates and Rating Evaluation Department, well, you have a data of in October, but for public data is between March and September. Property prices has increased by 8.8%. Rental during the corresponding period has shown an increase of 4.4%. So it's not the case that investment demand has pushed up property prices. Increasing the AVD rate will not be an effective measure, because we see that the rental in the rental market has increased as well. So how do you address the sharp increase of rental? Secretary, we have to increase supply. Without an increase in supply, there will be a tight supply level for both flats for sale and flats for rent. If we rely solely on AVD, it will not tackle the root of the problem. I agree. I never said that relying solely on AVD will solve the problem. But if we use any demand-side management, if we don't use any demand-side management, then you see that the market will go crazy. You don't want to see that. However, these measures are imposed on the property market for conveyancing, for sale. But you may say that 4.4% of rental is only half of the 8.8%. Between 2014 and 2016, we see that there is a total increase of 13% in rental. It's similar to property prices. I do see that there is a sharp increase in rental level. That's why I ask you, why do you only address speculation in the property market for sale and you've done nothing in the rental market? Since 2012, we have launched a number of demand-side management. From our experience, we see that every time we launch a new measure, there will be adjustment in property prices. There is a drop, and as a result, rental level dropped as well. For the rental level, it may be lower in percentage than that of property prices for sale. If we don't do anything, then there will be pressure for rental to increase. Mr. Jeremy Tam. I have some observations to make. In the past, these measures have failed to cool down the market. I think the main reason is not about the stamp duty, it's about mortgage. I know you have done something on the mortgage side, but you cannot do anything about developers providing a second mortgage. Youngsters try to save money. And what they've saved is just more or less the same amount as that of 10 years ago. So they are not able to buy a flat. And in the primary market, there are different ways. Say, for example, a second mortgage that will counter the effect of your demand-side management measures. Developers have seized the opportunity. So there are always flats of which the price will increase. And because of the prices increase in primary market, then flats in the secondary market would increase as well. If you don't do anything to stop developers from providing second mortgage to counteract the effect, then prices will continue to increase.
And we'll still see new flats in the form of subdivided flats. This is exactly as I said, newlywed couples only have limited money to spend and they are forced to buy that kind of flats. If you only increase the stamp duty and if you do not address the secondary mortgage for new flats, flat prices will continue to soar. Secretary, about mortgage and the mortgage ratio, the Hong Kong Monetary Authority has this policy to ensure the stability of the banking system in Hong Kong. So when there is an overheated property market, the Hong Kong MA would require more prudent adjustment measures. Of course, if there are more restrictions on mortgage, the desire of people buying property will be dampened. But then we don't only look at the property market, but also stability of our financial system. Developers may roll out different measures, but they have to act within the law. And in terms of sales techniques, we understand what techniques have been used, and we have seen that in the previous years. But then when it comes to demand control, objectively, there is a kind of power struggle between the government and developers. Say, for example, at the beginning of implementing the DSD, we saw such a scenario. But as to whether the measure was effective, we have considered that when we mapped out the new measure. Time is up. Let's see. I can see, yes. I will draw a line there because we also have the third item for discussion. After I've drawn the line, members who will come in will not be able to speak. Michael Luke and then Horace Jung. Thank you, Chairman. I'm very glad that council members are all very concerned about the soaring of property prices and think that the stamp duty measures may only tackle the symptoms, not the root of the problem. The root of the problem can only be addressed by increasing supply. I hope other members will support the forming of more land, and please do not demonize the building of private flats. In fact, private flats can also help to balance supply. Coming back to this AVD, which is increased to 15%, we believe it will have an impact of suppressing property prices. But I think, Secretary, you haven't answered a question. For people who buy property for the first time, they may be the scions of a very rich father, and they use the same contract, just one contract, to buy a few luxury flats. What can you do? Apart from this AVD, what about property vacant price tax or property or capital gains tax and also other measures? Will you consider that? And also, the HOS will help grassroots people buy property. It is an important policy. But some HOS have cost $6.89 million. It's so expensive. And so HOS is not effective in balancing or suppressing property prices. I hope you will review HOS prices so HOS can be affordable by the sandwich class. Secretary, about people using the same document to buy a few properties, I'll defer to the IRD. As for rent control, we have said many times on different occasions that when the supply is tight, rent control will not be effective, and in the short term, it may take property out of the market. And then capital gains tax, it is not just about property, it is about capital gains. Of course, Vancouver, we understand, has also started to do it. This is a matter of our overall taxation policy. It doesn't only involve property, but I'll take it back to the financial secretary. As for property vacant tax, you assume that the vacancy rate is very high, so you force people to rent out their property. But according to our figures, the private property vacancy rate is only 3.7%. The average should be 4.5%. In other words, there are not so many properties that are vacant. At any one time there must be some properties that are vacant. It's just like the unemployment rate. And if the unemployment rate is just over 3%, then it is almost full employment. Horace Cheung and then Eunice Yong.
Chairman, I support the present housing policy, and that is in the long term we have to supply more housing. In the short term, we need to have demand side control. I support that direction. But when you roll out tough measures, you must be careful whether we are going to affect people who buy property for the first time and those who really want to change property. Under the present stamp duty regime, I have seen three-person families who may be living in 200, 300 square feet flats, and they have saved up some money, so they want to move from a micro-sized flat to a small flat. But then, because of these stamp duties, they cannot do it. And as you say in the paper, you can buy property and then you have to sell your property within half a year so you get a refund. However, these families do not have a lot of money. They have to pay the 15% flat rate AVD first, and then they get a refund only within half a year when they sell the property. But in fact, it would be very difficult for them already to fork out the 15% AVD in the first instance. Administratively, can you do something for this batch of people who have a shortage of cash so they do not have to pay the tax upfront? Can you allow them not to pay the AVD when they buy property? Secretary,
in reality, we understand there will be a problem of cash flow, but we already provide exceptions and refunds, and we give you a period of 6 months. This is the existing mechanism. We hope there will not be such a big impact on cash flow when the period is not too long. We are not going to change the DSD. That has been the case since 2013, and the public know it very well. But then if you can't do this, you cannot really do what you say in the paper, and that is you don't want to add to the burden of Hong Kong people who really want to buy property. We are talking about 15% of the price, and after that you will give me a refund. I think that is a problem for many people. Many people have come to us for help. They want us to tell you, the administration, that they are genuine buyers of property and they are doing this for the next generation. You want to stamp out speculation. You want to suppress property prices. I'm not asking you to help me buy property. I'm just asking you not to add to my burden.
Chairman, at present, if a PR doesn't have beneficial interest in any property, then he will not be affected by the new AVD. Mr. Horace Cheung is talking about people who already have property and they want to change property, and so they may have a problem.
Any taxes may unavoidably affect certain groups of people. We don't rule that out. But it is not possible to make sure that no one will be affected.
Eunice Yong and then Ray Chen. On the 4th of November 2016, we have this new property, and that is at midnight it is implemented, and it is exactly a month into the implementation. Can I know whether it has been effective? How have transactions changed in the last month? Is it more people can buy property now, or have you been able to suppress property prices? I'd like to know the trend.
Do you have a long-term plan to cool the property market?
Suddenly, you have a new measure and it is implemented right away.
We understand you want nobody to be tipped off, but then I think you should have a long-term plan to control property prices so that they will not continue to spiral. I have seen the figures in your paper. The increase last month was 0.8%, lower than that of last year. But can you tell me exactly
how this measure has proved to be effective. Secretary, well, actually, in my speaking note and also in my paper, we know that the October prices have been lower than those of September by 0.8%. In other words, in the first quarter of the year, property prices have lowered somewhat, but then starting from the second quarter, prices have picked up, and then in August, September, October, the increases have been remarkable. So it's not like what the member said, that there is no relationship between these things. And also, there have been voices in the community that perhaps the administration should face the measure or the situation squarely. Of course, as the administration, we cannot consult on these measures because there will be an impact on the market. We, of course, have to roll out the measure in a way suddenly, but then there is no question of having support in the community. As you can see from the CU Hong Kong Institute of AP Studies findings, that there is a lot of support in the community, but this measure alone will not be able to direct the market. There are many factors affecting the property market. The most important one is supply demand. If there is an imbalance, if there are many people who really want to buy property and people who do not mind investing on more than one property, then certainly there will be a hike of prices. That is why we have to control demand. Apart from stamp duty measures, I hope there will be other measures so people will not think that you are at the end of your tether. Secretary, yes, we believe we need a multi-pronged approach. Ray Chen and then Fernando Zheng, today we are talking about whether the special measures are effective, but I have doubts about the new measure. In para 12, you say that if the market does not expect imminent interest increases, there will be more exuberance in the property market. Well, you know the American dollar is continuing to be strong, but there is depreciation of the renminbi. And that is why more wealthy people from the mainland have come to Hong Kong to scramble for property. Even if you have the new measure, mainlanders are still coming, and some of them actually would like to pay the 10% on behalf of the seller as well. It is said that a mainlander has to pay the 15% AVD and also the BSD, and altogether he has to pay an extra $2.7 million. And also there is an other owner who has not held the property for 10 years, so he has to pay $900,000 in extra tax, and they pay in one go. So you can see that these so-called tough measures are reduced in effectiveness because of the depreciation of renminbi. As you know, Hong Kong property is one of the ways for mainland people to take their capital away from the mainland. The mainland is saying that they would now stop people from taking capital away from the mainland. So would you help the central government? Would you disallow mainlanders from buying property in Hong Kong to dampen speculation? As Mr. Chan said, if it is a non-Hong Kong PR and he buys residential property, he has to pay the BSD and also the new 15% AVD. In other words, he has to pay 30% tax in total. If there is speculation, then you also have to pay the SSD. There may be extreme examples. I hope what you quoted is extreme. Well, he really likes the property. He has cash in his hands, so he doesn't mind. I mean, there are different consumption models in our society. But we look at the overall situation. We don't have conditions yet to release information about November. But looking at the development of the market, we see there are fewer transactions. And in terms of property prices, I think buyers are becoming cautious. Well, there are, of course, still some examples of people who do not mind the 15%. There may be these people, but I hope later on figures will show that the measure has been effective to a certain extent.
But as I've said, that property prices is not just a subject to changes in tax. Well, the liquidity and how much money people have will also affect buyers' behavior. Next is Dr. Fernando Zheng, to be followed by Leung Chi Cheng. Chairman, in Hong Kong, we have high rental, we have high property prices. This problem has been plaguing Hong Kong for a number of years. And the mortgage payment to income ratio at Q3 stands at 59%. That is, 60% of your income goes towards mortgage payment. This is simply crazy. This is nearly unacceptable. The government, however, thinks there is just an imbalance of demand and supply. That's why they launched demand-side management measures. And I fully agree with Dr. Edward Yu. It's the wrong diagnosis. According to the data of the Housing Department in 2016, there are about 2.47 million households. However, we have 2.7 million flats available. So there is a surplus of 240,000 flats. So it's not a problem of imbalance in demand and supply, but that of allocation. Who will be allocated a flat? Who owns more than one flat? That is the problem. We don't oppose your building more public housing as soon as possible because poor people don't have a roof over their heads. However, you launch these demand-side measures, DSD and a new flat rate. It is of no avail to cooling down the market, and it doesn't address the problem of allocation. We advocate rental control, especially rental of subdivided flats. Don't tell us that you don't have it, but at least tell us that you will consider the property vacancy tax. In Vancouver, they've just launched it. If a flat is left vacant for more than 6 months, this property vacancy tax will be imposed. Will you consider this property vacancy tax? Well, you talk about 200,000 empty flats of public housing, not just public housing, overall. This is not right. 2 years ago, someone else mentioned about this, and we explained in black and white what the actual situation is, and I will find the information for you. Well, there is no large number of vacant flats in the PRH sector. It's very low, just 0.something%. In relation to property vacancy tax, of course, other countries impose measures to force property owners to make available their flats is the problem. We have a 3.7% of PRH vacancy rate. It's very low. Well, as I said, we will consider all possible measures, including tax. Mr. Leung Chi Cheng, the launching of this new measure has somewhat cooled down property market, but it hasn't driven down property prices. It's different from last time, because last time both market sentiment and property prices have been dampened. And it shows that the problem is more serious. Immediately, there is no flat for rent. So if you don't have a flat and you want to rent one, you won't be able to find any flats that are available for rental. You have launched the measure. You aim to rein in the property market. However, when you launch this measure, it brings other problems. And some people from the property, from the real estate sector, said that it only tackles the symptom. And they have floated some solutions, just like the Hong Kong land for Hong Kong people, just like what the CE said. So do you have any other supporting measures to support this demand side management to address this distorted situation? Before 2013, before the really harsh measures, there was someone said that flats should be smaller. But now you see some small flats, just about 100 square feet or so, and they sold like hot cakes. Young people want to have their own property. So there is this distorted situation in Hong Kong. Small flats sell well, and they don't have to pay much in tax. And you have a tiny flat that is your own. What is well known that Hong Kong people are enslaved to their home, and the burden has increased. So do you have any supporting measures in that will be launched in tandem with this new measures? Well, we have to increase supply, because nothing will take away the problem when there is an imbalance. Even if we launch a rent control, well, whether property prices drop or not depends on the situation. Mr. Cheung talked about the DSD, the BSD in 2013. There was no immediate reaction, because if you own a property or if you're a developer, you need to gauge the situation before reacting to it. Mr. Eddie Ju, thank you. For Hong Kong people like me, our wish is not to climb on the property ladder, but to have a comfortable home. So if we're given choices, if the government can provide stable housing for us, say for example, flats for rent, then we don't have to try to climb onto the property ladder. Land supply. We were talking about the rezoning of Greenbelt in Tai Po. 60% of available land is used for private housing, whether it's for public housing, whether it's a rental or for sales, only about 30 to 40%. Do you think you need to adjust this ratio? For our long-term housing strategy, we proposed that for the coming 10 years, for new flats, public housing will account for 60%, whereas private will account for 40%. I was talking about land. So we use units. Flat number of flats as the unit. So 200,000 will be for rental, and 80,000 will be for sale. For public housing, there are about 1/3 of Hong Kong population living in public housing. In the coming 10 years, we will increase the number greatly to push it to close to 1 million. For Singapore, the government housing mostly is for sale. So the ratio for rental in Hong Kong is not low. I see that a lot of housing land has been sold to developers to build flats. They do that to generate fund for capital works. So is it the mentality of the government that every year a certain amount of land has to be sold to generate income? Is there a target that you have to sell a certain amount of land to generate a certain number of level of income? I think it's a question for the FS. Mr. Lai, would you like to answer? I can say for sure that for the Capital Works Fund, it's not affected by revenue of land sale, because if it falls short, we will use general revenue to pay our bills. Deputy Chairman and then Mr. James Toh. Just now, the Secretary said that they will not give up adopting a multi-pronged approach to address property prices problems. And the limited effect of these measures is something we can see. Someone mentioned about property vacancy tax. The Secretary did not answer. Dr. Fernando Zheng talked about Vancouver. I think it is of high reference value. It's only 1%. It will come into effect in January. We see property prices has dropped by 40%. We see that the volume of transaction has dropped by 40%. So is it worth considering imposing this property vacancy tax? Because there will never be a conclusion. Some groups have done some statistics. Using the statistics and census, well, actually, there is a difference between the number of flats and the number of flats with people living in it, difference of 10%. So, by what you said, since you have launched these measures and these measures are of limited effectiveness, would you consider property vacancy tax? About car parking spaces, with these measures, well, within a very short time, end of October, 1,000 transactions of car parking spaces. And the average of one parking space will fetch $4 million. Well, are you worried that it will get worse? When we decided to launch the new flat rate of 15% of AVD, we were aware of the situation of residential housing. For non-residential property, the prices were stable, and in the past few months, there was a drop. Of course, we would not lose sight of the trend of any market. We'll continue to monitor the situation. For property vacancy tax, yes. Well, in Vancouver, the volume of transaction has dropped by 50%. And if we introduce, well, after we have introduced the 15%, the volume of transaction has immediately dropped by 40%? Not 40%. I can't give you the figure. Centerline said that there is not 40%. Secretary, would you please answer? Well, if this is an effective measure, would you consider it or not? I've explained why that several years ago, about 3 years ago, we considered the vacancy tax. It was discussed in the Long-Term Housing Strategy Steering Committee, and we've explained why we did not decide not to impose it. Well, if any member would like to give us information, please give us that in the written form. Mr. Cheng Chung Tai, we see that these measures are not effective. Have you underestimated the capability of developers? We see that property prices have not only remained stable, they have increased as well. Well, I'm not going to repeat my question about property vacancy tax. I want to ask about your speaking notes. Page 3, it says that you will propose to retain the refund mechanism in relation to Hong Kong permanent residents changing the flat they own by acquisition before disposal. So it's that is the case that you buy a property and then within 6 months you dispose of the old one and then you will get a refund. Is it a new measure? No, this is not the new measure. It's an existing mechanism. So I was actually talking about the latest measure. Sorry, I was going to ask you something about acquisition before disposal. There hasn't been any changes. We will retain all exemptions and refund mechanism. 6 months is impossible. Within six months, you have to dispose of your old flat before you are eligible for refund. So you will take 15% from me, and you require me to dispose of my old flat within 6 months. It's impossible.
Therefore, when I saw this paragraph, I thought you were saying you would reconsider these 6 months, but you're not going to, right? Well, I was talking about the overall 15%. Sorry, I misread the paragraph. Would you like to say more? No. I just misread those two lines in the speaking note. Do you think 6 months is too long, too short, or just right? Too short. It is impossible for people to sell off their property within 6 months after they have bought a property, because you are actually combating against the property buying desire of locals, and you are harming the locals. But the large developers and the mainlanders, if they can hold on to their property because they have a lot of cash, I don't think they will be affected by any measures at all, unless you consider a property vacancy tax. Thank you. Anything else? Well, I will not overestimate the effectiveness of the property vacancy tax. I know some members have mentioned it, and I'll relate this to the FS. Next, Leung Kwok Hong, and then Jonathan Ho. Mr. Edward Yu. Now, I will read out some figures. In June this year, total transactions, including factories and shops, 6,033, and then residential, 4,620. In July, total transactions, 5,324, residential, 4,243. And then August, total transactions, 7,430, residential, 821. In September, the peak. Total transactions, 9,504, residential, 7,826. And then October, it dropped somewhat. Total transactions, 8,560, residential, 6,601. November, total transactions, 8,618, residential, 6,739. You only have 2 minutes. Well, I read out all the figures. So what is the result? There was a sudden surge in September. So you thought you had to do something. There were more transactions, and prices also went up, unless it was some panic sale. Now, what is the problem here, Mr. Secretary? You said property vacancy tax would not be effective, but do it first. It's just like how many poor people there are. When you say there would be relief measures, they would suddenly come forward to be assessed. And if you ask them to pay tax, they have to. If they don't, then they are cheating the government. Once you implement a property vacancy tax, say for example, there are 20,000, they will have to report to you. Do not argue. It happens in Canada. Once you implement it, you will know the situation. But of course, you are the smartest. You have the ABD, DSD, BSD. You will implement whatever you can think of. But if renminbi continues to depreciate, people estimate that they can get back the 15%, they will continue to do it, because some people will pay on their behalf. Jeremy Tam said sometimes the developer would pay on their behalf, so they continue to buy property. Think. They may say if there are others who pay on their behalf, they will just continue to make money. You cannot do anything with that. It's as simple as that. The market has already found measures to counteract your measures, and you dare not implement the vacancy tax. Next, Jonathan Ho. Well, it's clear that there are market signals, and the signals are telling us that the renminbi is depreciating and it is best to use Hong Kong dollars to buy property. Since we have full employment, I think we have a more stable environment than in the US. Why is it that our property prices continue at a high level? I understand supply is not controlled by you, but why not increase supply, especially HOS, so Hong Kong people can buy property more easily? Like in Cha Kwa Leng in Kwun Tong, it has been rezoned from residential to other uses, and the development of that site is held up. Are you deliberate in holding up sites? What about the Anderson site for private housing? Why don't you bring it forward? So you send a signal to the market that in the foreseeable future there will be more supply, so prices will not go crazy. We are having land that has been planned in the 90s, like in Tin Shui Wai and Tung Chung. And many councillors here would like to block you. They won't allow you to reclaim land from the sea in East Lantau and in Tung Chung, and that is why they are helping you to buttress property prices. I hope you will find land so you send out signals to the market. There will be more supply. Secretary, from the building of public housing perspective of the HA, we will make the best use of every site, big or small. As to how the market will understand the supply situation, well, yes, there have been challenges and even blockade while we want to launch certain housing projects, and the market may think that we have difficulty in providing more housing. Well, yes, we'd like to have the council support, therefore. And now I'd like to refer to some figures. I was mentioning non-residential property in the first three quarters of this year up to September. Offices, retail shops and flatted factories. The prices have dropped by 6.1%, 4.8% and 2.8% respectively. That is why I said prices have dropped in the recent quarters. As for the recent 1 to 2 months, we will look at the prices again. Anything to add? What about sending a signal to the market so you can cool the market? Well, talking about signals, I think the community is clear that we put housing as our first priority. We are working at our level best to provide new housing. Thank you, Secretary. We will now go on to the next agenda item, and that is the updates on issues arising from the excess lead in drinking water in public rental housing estates incident. I'd like to prolong the meeting by 15 minutes. We should end the meeting at 4:40, but now the meeting will end at 4:55. I won't introduce the team from the administration. Is it that, Mr. Ying, you are going to let us know more about the issue? Chairman, my colleagues are coming in. Chairman, since we have already given you the papers beforehand, and in fact we have reported the information therein to the public before, I don't think we need to introduce the papers. But then in the past period, the HA has been working on a quality monitoring scheme. If we have the time, maybe I can ask Ada to introduce the paper that has just been tabled. Thank you, Chairman. The paper has been tabled, it's risk assessment. Yes, I'd like to turn to this very short paper on risk assessment. In response to the report of the Commission on Inquiry into Excess Lead Found in Drinking Water Recommendation, para 487, bracket 12, quote, HA should, in consultation with WSD, review all the materials to be used in the construction of PRH estates with a view to identifying the potential hazards and contamination in the drinking water and revising the project specifications as necessary. We are getting on with this work. And their recommendation, para 487, bracket 13, co-HA should put in place a robust system to monitor the compliance of the plumbing installations with the project specifications by main contractors and subcontractors. And in view of this paragraph, where the scope is quite high, we have used, in fact, we have done a risk assessment exercise on all building materials used as set out in the Hong Kong HA Specification Library 2014 edition. Architectural, more than 1,000. Building surfaces, more than 600. Structural, more than 60. Altogether, about 2,000. We'll manage the risk. Sorry, Ada. Didi, if you are just reading out the paper, why don't we go directly into our discussion? Now, I'd like to tell you what kind of specification we use to manage the risk on contractors using materials that may deviate from the specification. We believe there may be some incentive that may lead to deviation, and there are 7. 1. Money. 2. Less work. 3. Escape from checking. 4. Lack of awareness. 5. Lack of skill. 6. Deficiency record. 7. New material. These are likelihood aspects. And then as for the consequence, there are a few levels. 1. Statutory non-compliance. 2. Functionality. 3. Safety of workers, users and properties. And then 4. Health of workers, users. 5. Project progress. Final results of the risk assessment will form the basis for establishing the material control mechanism. Will incorporate into the enhanced quality control system on material compliance checking and monitoring, which will include updating of contract requirements, specifications, technical guides, and the site inspection procedures. Thank you. Since our meeting can go on only until 5 to 5 and 6 members would like to speak, every member will have 4 minutes. Please do not exceed the time, or else other members will not have the opportunity to speak. Helena Wong, Lo Wai Kok, and then 4 more. Helena Wong. Thank you. Chairman, just now, Ada mentioned the risk assessment paper. I have a short question on that. At PRH construction sites, if you sample check these materials, do you include the soldering material and also the valves, etc.? Didi? Indeed, we have stepped up random checking. This started last year. It was in 2015. Would you like to give us a list what you random check at the sites? I can supply after the meeting because it's a long list. Thank you. Number 2. We understand that you are doing rectification works for 11 affected estates, including installations in the flats. I'd like to know whether you also work after office hours and on weekends, because some people have to work and they can't wait for you during office hours at home. We understand that there are these special arrangements. Okay, and then para 10 of the paper, which says that when contractors have finished the rectification works, that is all the standpipes and also in-house pipes, you say you will again test the water samples. You do so according to the circular letters of WSD number 5/2015 and number 1/2015. I have seen these circular letters. You say lead should not be more than 10 milligram. And then 5/2015 talks about how samples should be taken. And the WSD teaches people how to get water samples. And the WSD still says that you have to flush the tap for 2 to 5 minutes before you take a sample. However, the Commission on Inquiry has already said that if you flush the tap for 2 to 5 minutes, you are almost getting a sample as that from a standpipe, not the new water sample from the new pipes, both inside the house and on the external wall. And the COI report asks you to test the first draw. And even after rectification, you are still asking people to flush the water tap for 2 to 5 minutes first. Then you are wasting taxpayers' money because you just can't get a real sample.
So can you answer the question, please? Assistant Director. Or permanent secretary. Let me answer first. Well, for the WSD circular letter number 5, number 1, it doesn't just target the housing authority. It covers all flats in Hong Kong. But you said that the contractors will follow this old guideline, but it fails to gauge whether the whether there are any problems with the water or with the pipes. But that is the prevailing water test. But if it fails to address the problem, what's the point of doing water test? Well, for the 11 affected estates, after the waterworks replacement, the Water Supplies Authority will need to confirm that the water quality is in order. Yes, you replace the pipes, you need to test the water, and you need to test the first draw. If you let the tap flush for 2 to 5 minutes, you cannot test whether the water in the pipe has been contaminated. Next, Mr. Lo Wai Kwok. I know that when it comes to public housing estates where pipes have to be replaced, well, works in common area has met with little resistance. However, when it comes to domestic units, I hear from the housing authority that some tenants are reluctant to have the pipes replaced. And even when it comes to water sampling tests, not all flats show that there are problems. Some units may feel safe after the pipes in the common area has been replaced. They may not want to replace the pipes inside the unit, so can they opt out? In the paper, you said that tenants may opt out. However, you said that well, for health reasons, you will encourage tenants to have the pipes replaced. So is it the case that actually there is no choice? Well, shouldn't you give some tenants the choice? Maybe tenants just want to have the water tested without changing the pipes. In the past few months, when we're considering how to work on pipe replacement inside the flat, well, we liaise with the WSD. The WSD will have to rely on Waterworks Ordinance and the regulations. We strongly encourage tenants to have the pipes replaced. If they are not available, maybe we'll ask them again after work has been completed, because we have some spare time. So for quite some time, we will continue with our work. It depends on the situation. Well, in the end, we will report to the WSD in accordance with the Waterworks Ordinance. We will report that to the WSD for them to consider it. Just now, you said that we're under the Waterworks Regulation. There are legal obligations on the tenant. So in the end, the tenants will have to have the pipes replaced. Or is it the case that you will talk to the WSD? There is still flexibility for tenants to opt out. Well, 7A is where we stand in our discussion with the WSD. For the housing authority, it's very clear. If the government said that pipes inside the flat should be replaced, the HA will endeavour to do so. The tenancy agreement states that tenants should allow the landlord to conduct some works. We have some flexibility. If they don't want to have the works done now, then we will ask them again later. Hopefully, they will give us the time to do it. I do think you should be flexible and you should be more reasonable. If pipes in common areas have been replaced and if you replaced pipes in some units, and for those who don't want to have the pipes replaced, they may allow you to test the water inside the unit, and if it shows to be all right, then there may not be any need to replace the pipes. Dr. K.K. Kwok. Well, the PS said that for the 11 affected estates, the government will do everything they can. And it's not just about these 11 estates. And recently, there has been some incident about some fragments of metal in water. Well, other than those completed in before 2005, there are still some public housing estates that may have problem with the water. Residents are concerned. I'm sure you have some scientific method, but can you give the undertaking that you will test for lead in water in all public housing estates? Because this way you will give assurance to PRH tenants that the water is safe. Starting from July to December last year, we have by phases tested water for lead in public housing estates. The results have been made public. 11 estates have been affected because the water sample result shows to be positive. That means it contained excessive lead. That's why contractors are working on the replacement of pipes to make sure that there will not be any excess lead in drinking water. So you have tested water in all public housing estates, and apart from these 11 estates, all others are safe. Yes, it was done last year. Can you give us some data on paper about the level of lead in water in all public housing estates? What about apart from lead? Well, recently we've heard about some metal debris and maybe some other substance. Well, in paragraphs 20 to 24, you find the information about the work we have done in the past few months in our water sampling test results. Unfortunately, there has been some discrepancies, and we've given you the information. And in relation to how many estates we've tested and how many units, you will find the information in the annex. If you want more information, just let us know. In relation to some unwanted substance, well, before the excess lead in water, WSD required tests to be done to test for various substances, one of which is iron. Well, now we test for 12, which is more than previously required. Sometimes when problems are found in a water, I think the problem should be followed up by the established procedure of the WSD. So other than the 11 affected estates, the water of all other estates is in order. Is that right? Yes. That includes heavy metal. Right. Mr. Wilson Orr, for Ngau Tau Kok Lower Estate, Kwai Yut House, it's a trial. And some units have required, I feel that they are reluctant to have pipes replaced inside. And you said in the paper that you will have to consider the HA and the tenants' legal obligations under the Waterworks Ordinance or Waterworks Regulation. So please give us more information. If a tenant refuses to have the pipes replaced, is it a choice? Mr. Lo Wai Kok said that the HA would approach the WSD and liaise with the tenant. What if the tenants, are adamant to not have the pipe replaced? We will provide accurate information to tenants and to members. The WSD told us that we have to abide by the ordinance. Our approach is the same as all similar works in the past. We will give flexibility to tenants. if they found it inconvenient to have the works done now, then we'll ask them later. We'll approach them later. Thank you. Please seriously consider this approach. You should not cause inconvenience to tenants whilst ensuring safe drinking water. And as at the 25th of November, only 65 of the units in Kwai Yut House have the pipes replaced. But when it comes to having to remove fixtures or when there are possible damage to furniture, of course, you need to consider compensation. I would like to ask on behalf of the affected tenants, if there are problems in the course of the work, will there be compensation or not? And where will it come from the department or from the contractor? I'll defer to Sandra. Ms. Lam. Thank you. The trial started in the 17th of October at Kwai Yut House. The contractor arranged for interviews with the tenants. Actual work started on the 2nd of November. It's been a month or so. Sundays and public holidays, there won't be any work done. So every day, the contractor will work on 4 units. And so far, from what we've learned from contractors, tenants have not raised any issues about problems with damaging their furnishings. No, but it doesn't. Well, it's no mention. If there is no mention, it doesn't mean that there are no problems. If something's damaged, who is to pay compensation? If you find in paragraph 7B at the end. Well, one of the points we have discussed with contractors is that if there are any damages done, then the contractors will have to communicate with tenants about claims. Thank you. Next, Mr. Cheng Chung Tai and Dr. Fernando Zheng. I think the demand of the affected tenants is very clear. They would like the responsible officials to bear responsibility. So far, we have not seen anything in reports that any officials will have to step down as a result. About contractors and compensation, I see in this paper, in 18A, it talks about actions against contractors. So 18A and B, it says that for the household of the 11 affected estates, well, $660 in subsidy will be given to pay water and sewage charges for 3 years. Is now in place? Yes. So any details about this arrangement? Any applications required? I see the wording. It's a subsidy, it's not a compensation. So can you explain? Why is arranged in such a way? Well, in this panel and in the House Committee, we have explained to members. If members are interested, I will dig up the information for you. There are 4 contractors. For various considerations at that time, agreements were reached that we will pay part of their water and sewage charges at $660 starting from the 1st of January 2016 for 3 years. Because for some units, they pay very little in water charges. Well, what I say may not be completely accurate, but there are some papers. I will find the paper for you and give you the information. And for 18B, well, there is a performance bond, 5,000 per flat. So this is in relation to the remedial measures. That includes a replacement of pipes, and if water tests are found to be unsatisfactory, then the tenant may, through the HA, ask for $5,000 in compensation. There has been some detailed discussion. Let me give you a quick answer. Well, the HA has reached an agreement contract with four contractors.
And to the HA, we think the contractors have not really discharged their duties under the contract. Later on, they have to replace the pipes, etc. We are asking them to continue to discharge their obligations under the contract. And in the tender committee of the HA, in order to make sure that they will discharge all their duties under the contract, there will be a deposit of $5,000 for each flat. It is not whether the $5,000 will be given to anybody, but all the four contractors have to write a bond to the HA, and it is calculated on the basis of $5,000 per flat. If their obligations are not discharged, the HA can forfeit the bond. This is an extra guarantee to make sure that the contractors will discharge the terms of the contract. In other words, the HA can look at the situation in different estates and say, for example, in a certain flat, the water supply system or the filters have not been dealt with, then the bond can be activated. I'd like to know whether you have done anything with the bond so far.
P.S.
My understanding is that for the HA and the contractors, the HA will certainly make sure that the contractors will discharge their obligations under every contract. Last member, Fernando Zheng. Ever since the COI report was released, in fact, it pointed out that there was collective negligence of duty on the part of the government. But unfortunately, the report had been released for so long and there has been no apologies, no heads were rolled, and there is now a collective refusal to accept responsibility. In the report, it is said that over 100 children were affected, and there are experts' reports pointing out, well, actually, it is Professor Lee, the Vice Chancellor of UST. He said that there were 3,000 samples taken, but he thought that there were problems. He said that in 6 or 5 PRH estates, he found that the lead content was also exceeded, including Shui Chun O Estate, Choi Tech, Yi Ming, Kwai Chung, and also Yun Chao Estate. Of course, the administration wouldn't accept. And Professor Lee said that he took 645 samples, including first draws. 47.2% exhibited an exceedance. And compared to the flushed sample of the administration, where only 8% exceeded the standard, Professor Lee is of the view that the administration's sampling could not reflect the real situation. My question for you is, the expert witness report has been released, and today you are still telling us that you have tested all other estates using flushed samples and you say there is no problem. How can you reassure the residents of these estates, especially the 5 that are read out? They are not within the 11 affected estates. You don't do anything. But then my UST Vice Chancellor said that 47% of the samples exceeded the standard. And also, in the COI report, 126 children had too much lead in their blood, and 10 have been found to have been affected in their developmental phases, and 33 will have to have their blood retested. I'd like to ask about the present situation of these children. P.S. First, the first question. I think the member was asking about the way we take water samples. The COI made its own recommendation. I don't think I have to read it out. Actually, the WSD and the Development Bureau already told members that to follow up on the COI proposals, they are doing something. They have invited experts to come, and they said that come March next year, after they have completed their present task, they will let you know what new thinking they may have. On the 30th of November, there was a written question from Dr. Helena Wong, and we gave a written reply after talking to the Development Bureau, and the details are given in that written reply. They have invited experts to come to Hong Kong. I think, members, will know the findings of that research in March next year. As for children whose blood has been tainted with too much lead, do we have the updated information? Sorry, we have to go back and find the answer because we are all from the Housing Bureau here. But then previously, even the Department of Health and Development Bureau and other people were represented. I hope you will give me the information because we are very concerned and worried about the welfare of residents. Yes, they are PRX residents. We need the information next time, all right? Since time is almost up, I'd like to thank you for your cooperation, members, so that we can complete our discussion of all three items, and we thank the officials. There is nothing under AOB meeting adjourned.